Welcome. Good evening. There you go. We'll try that again. Good evening. Good evening. Ah, yeah. Too big of a crowd for such a small response. My name is Jennifer Oz Freeman. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm the assistant professor and program director of theology and the arts. Thank you, here at United. It's my pleasure to welcome you to Unearthed, which is the culminating event of this year's Arts Practicum course. In this class, students develop projects around key theological and spiritual questions in a medium of their choosing. In many ways, the works you've encountered in the gallery, and for those of you on Zoom, we will have a virtual exhibit on the United blog in the coming week or so. So stay tuned for that. And the works you're going to hear about tonight are a reflection of courses and conversations and experiences from the past several years, and in some cases, decades of our students. The title Unearthed was selected by the class and reflects the common threads of memory, embodiment, loss, and exploration, and the sacred that weave through each body of work. On behalf of the Praxis cohort, I'd like to thank the guest artists who visited our class and spoke about their work with us: Ebony Adedayo, Danielle Arzola, Max Brumberg-Kraus, Benedict Scheuer, and Cheryl Schweihart. I'd also like to thank Jeffrey Wilser for playing the piano this evening. And my thanks to the Reverend Dr. Cindy Beth Johnson, Michael Mua, Laura Larson, Andrew Fox, and Ashley Hobel, who have supported the installation of the exhibit and the advertising and so on for this evening. In terms of logistics, we have a large group of students. I'm going to be introducing each of our artists individually. We'll have a brief intermission. We'll save our Q&A for the end of the evening and have some reflection and conversation. And did I already say we'll have a little intermission too? So feel free, lots of delicious food and beverages if for those of you who are in person, to help yourselves. To be perfectly honest, this is my favorite class of the classes that I teach at United. It's very fulfilling to teach because it's this moment where students are looking back at their careers and kind of staking their own kind of claim or their own perspective on the relationship between theology and the arts. And I really see my role as kind of a witness and a midwife to that process. So for me, it's always just very inspiring and exciting to marvel at their creativity. I learn so much from them and from the process of the class. This semester in particular, this is the first arts practicum in the pandemic. And this semester in particular has been both very raw and beautiful. And tonight is incredibly bittersweet in the celebration of our students' work because of the recent and sudden death of Matthew Nelson, one of our students. Matthew is an artist through and through. Tonight, I'm wearing my coveralls in his honor. Painted overalls were a staple of Matthew's wardrobe. And tonight, he was planning on wearing what he referred to as his fancy overalls. Yes, that is the overalls that didn't have paint on them. So in his honor, I'm wearing my fancy overalls, which don't have paint on them. Matthew's studio practice always started with lighting a candle and inviting the spirit of creativity into his studio space in whatever form. So to begin our evening, I'd ask you to join me now in a moment of silence, and if our artist can come up with me, as we light a candle in Matthew's memory, and I'd encourage you all to take this moment to just invite that spirit of creativity into your own life in the next few moments, the evening, the coming days and weeks, and maybe, you know, make something playful and think about Matthew. Thank you. I'm using this so that my hands don't shake.
They're still going to shake.
Thank you. There are Kleenexes at the back of the chapel. Thank you so much. We are going to begin with Dustin Wilser's work, and we will follow the schedule that you have in your program after that, including that brief intermission. We will end with a reflection on Matthew's work and a song sung by Dustin and Ariel. And then we'll follow that with some time for reflection and conversation to give you a picture of our evening. So for the sake of time, I'm not going to read the full bios that the artists have supplied for us. I'll refer you to the program for that. And I will try to keep my comments short to move things along. So of the many things that I appreciate about Dustin Wilser and enjoy about him, his humor, musical talent, his joie de vivre in general, his ability to wear pants as a scarf. one of the things I appreciate most is his willingness to follow the spirit of artistic inspiration, even and especially when it brings him into unknown territories and new media. And it's been just so encouraging and inspiring to see you kind of follow those like curiosities. See, I'm going off script, so I should stop talking. but it's just great to see you kind of experiment as an artist, and it inspires me to do the same. So, yes.
I'm one of a kind. Where?
Wait a second, I have to show my iPad my face or I won't know what I'm supposed to say. On January 25th, 1996, Jonathan Larson died the night that his first Broadway show was set to open. And instead of canceling that performance, they chose to make that a night of celebration of his life and his art. That's what musical theater can do. And I didn't know that I was going to be opening tonight with a story about the musical that I wrote with my husband for this class as a celebration of Matthew's life. But I'm so glad that I get the opportunity to do that. So I'm gonna share this. Yeah. That's gonna be problematic. Matthew and Mark both tell us that one day, while Jesus was speaking to a crowd, his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and they called him. Someone in the crowd told him, "Look, your mother and brothers and sisters are outside asking for you." And what did Jesus say in reply? "Who is my mother? And who are my brothers?" I guess he was already clear on who his sisters were. Who is my mother? The theological point that Jesus is trying to make here is that in the kingdom of God, we are all welcome as if one family, as close to one another as we are to our earthly mother. Knowing that, however, doesn't change the fact that in response to someone telling him that his mother needed to speak with him, Jesus said, "Who is my mother?" I mean, she's standing right there. She can hear you. And let me tell you something, 32 years old is not too old for your mother to lead you home by the ear telling you all the ways you made her life hell. Even if you are God. It was from this place that I began to conceive the idea for Mother of God, an Immaculate Musical. What must it have been like to be the human mother of Jesus of Nazareth? To be the human mother of God. And what are the implications for God? To be experiencing for the first time a mother's love, a mother's anger, a mother's care, a mother's guilt, a Jewish mother's guilt. Who is Mary? And what does the life and ministry of Jesus look like through her? Lights go down. Single pinpoint spotlight on a pitch black stage reveals a young woman.
I am not a doll.
18.
I am not a painting.
Early 20s.
I am not a candle to be lit. I am not a god. I am not a dream.
Second woman.
I am not a legend.
Younger than the first.
I am a single point of view. I am a camera. What are you? If I had understood a bit more from the beginning.
A third.
If I had had the opportunity to ask.
Older than the first.
If any person ever really could prepare.
Together they all sing.
I am 7 hours.
I am 7 hours.
I am 7 currents.
I am 7 currents.
I am 40 days of night. I am snow. I am crystal lee.
I am Dolores.
I am Marilyn Monroe.
I am the new Bridget Bardot.
If I had understood a bit more from the beginning, if I had had the opportunity to ask, if any person
the answer to the question, who is Mary, is not an easy one. Yet another woman in history defined by sex, or lack thereof.
I am Madonna, I am virtue made of glass.
I am Madonna, I am virtue made of glass.
I am Madonna, I am virtue.
The mother of Jesus plays an important role in every canonical account of the gospel. She can be found in Acts and Revelation. She's the only female prophet and only named female character in the Quran. The Proto-Evangelium of James, the Infancy Gospel of Thomas, and other books of the Apocrypha tell of Mary's birth and childhood. Robust accounts of the conception and birth of Jesus and Mary as a young mother to a Jesus in boyhood. She is La Virgen de Guadalupe. Many hold her in godlike reverence. Using all these sources, the three women, symbols of Mary in different stages of life, will help us make sense of the vast and varied tales, while exploring her thoughts, her doubts, and her faith. As our opening song fades to an end, we find ourselves in the modern day Jerusalem. On the Via Dolorosa, between the Dome on the Rock and the Muslim residential quarter. Above a small door is a sign which reads, Birthplace of the Virgin Mary, the beginning of our journey back in time. We go inside, see the sights, through the dark and through the damp, into a grotto, where we find ourselves transported into the first century BCE. Standing inside the self-described house of the righteous ancestors of God. Saint Joachim and Saint Anne, Mary's mother and father, the grandparents of Jesus. In the play, I refer to Anne as Hannah. the Hebrew name that means Anne. Luke uses the story of Hannah in 1 Samuel as a template for telling the story of the mother of Jesus. By calling Mary's mother Hannah, I'm hoping to draw the 1 Samuel story closer to front of mind, while also recognizing the parallels of Anne's story. As the music quickly moves us through the early life of Mary, we witness her Annunciation, sent to the world with the express purpose of being the human mother of God, sent to live in the temple, cared for by the priests and fed by angels, betrothed to Joseph upon her maturity, left at home alone while he went away on business. And while he's gone, of course, miraculous conception. As Mary spins thread for a new temple veil, she hears a rustling in the trees, a movement here and there. Someone is watching Mary. We can sense his presence, but we never see him clearly. In his book, A Complicated Pregnancy, Dean Roberts says, "Surely the incarnation of the Son of God as human history didn't require a miraculous beginning. If Jesus Christ, the divine Son of God, were conceived by human procreation, he was no less God's gift to the world." A word, however, for consent. And Dean Roberts would agree with me on this. Mary is a child. Even as it is told canonically, one day she is simply instructed that she will now become impregnated by God. And her response is, "I am a servant of my God. I live to do your will." It's unclear, however, if she could have said no if she wanted to. How does one say no to God? I just lost my page a little bit, so 1 second. Jane Schauberg's work, The Illegitimacy of Jesus, argues that Jesus was most probably the result of rape. This memory was preserved by the family of Jesus. Christians understood this conception to be entirely natural, but also the work of the Holy Spirit in cooperation with God. From there, the couple is put on trial for indecency, travels to Bethlehem on that fateful Christmas Eve. They are invited by a midwife to stay with her family in the living quarters of her family's inn. They stay there for 8 days and journey back home, leaving a trail of accidental baby Jesus miracles in their wake. As she ages into the next stage of her life, she becomes a powerful protector, fleeing to Egypt to protect her toddler, wandering here and there anytime the strange behavior of her son causes unrest. As we close Act One, it's the Passover festival in Jerusalem. The Holy Family has returned from Egypt, and in the hustle and bustle of the crowd, Jesus becomes separated from the family. After a frantic search, she finds him in the temple. In a mixture of fear and anger, she shouts, "Where have you been? I was terrified. Didn't you know I would be in the house of my father?" he says cheekily. "And where has your father been?" she snaps back. "You, oh holy child, you think that you are God, but I am still your mother." As the music transitions us into the third version of Mary, we find ourselves at the wedding banquet in Cana, following Jesus' ministry as she supports, encourages, and follows, mostly from a distance, until that fateful night, again at the Passover festival, as she watches her son die, she cries, "I will care for you, oh my child. I will care for you as any mother would do. I will care for you, holy child. I know that you are God, but I am still your mother." Thank you.
Thank you, Dustin. Elena Hoffman. I've known Elena Hoffman for more than 20 years. I recently had the great joy and honor of being witness to her passionate and deep thinking around the intersections of justice and theology when she defended her thesis on Little Women and the Transcendentalists. I commend it to you all for your reading. Elena is a woman of so many talents: storyteller, comedian, artist, theologian, chaplain in the making, equestrian, no, not an equestrian, and a friend. Elena has the rare gift of being able to be present with people, truly, truly present, to see them and to celebrate them, to come alongside of them, to give them a word. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Okay, I'll stop. I am continually grateful to know you, Elena.
Let's see how this goes. I'm going to talk to you about my art by starting with a story that happened in undergrad for me. I had the opportunity to travel in Turkey and Greece for a month and follow the missionary journeys of the Apostle Paul. And while we were in Turkey, we visited a place where they made rugs. And we were watching a woman tie each knot of a rug. And as we're watching, we're told that in her lifetime, she would be able to make, you know, a certain amount. It was like 11 or 12 rugs in her lifetime. And if she was making silk ones, she would be able to make maybe 5 to 7, because the light shining on the silk thread would eventually blind her from being so focused on the tight knots of the rug. And watching this happen, watching this woman continue to tie knots, and recognizing that we are saying that this part of her is worth a rug, it's not worth a rug. It's not. Thanks. And that question about what it means to be a consumer has really stuck with me. What does it mean to be an ethical consumer? Is that even possible? But that's the world I live in and I have to engage with. When a friend of mine recently told me the phrase bread and roses, it just struck me. And I was like, stop talking. What have you just said? What is that? Is that something you just made up, or is that a something that existed? And he gave me some of the history on bread and roses as a protest slogan and how it became the first textile strike that actually created new working environments for people in the US, kind of a prototype for unions. And being able to dig into the history of that phrase and how it's been used in so many protests since then. It looks at bread being what our bodies need, nourishment for our bodies, and roses being what our souls need, because we are human beings. And we need nature and art and our spiritual lives, and looking at those being connected. One of the first works that I wanted to make was a single line drawing that made those two connected. And I thought it would be cool to have as a tattoo, but I didn't know that I wanted another tattoo, and I like to challenge people. So in our first class, I was like, I'm gonna design a tattoo and someone should get it. And like half the class raised their hand without even seeing any, without any idea of what I was going to doodle for them, which I thought was so beautiful. And then how awesome is it when you have your professor show up to class and say, I got the tattoo? Like, round of applause, please. which made me think that I better. So I've got my Bread and Roses tattoo. so that was one of the pieces. But also thinking about Jennifer Oz Freeman came into theology class with Dr. Wheeler and talked about liberation theology and introduced this idea of neighbor as sacrament. And neighbor as sacrament really connected for me to that story of the woman who was tying knots. And the idea of caring for your neighbor as being like a holy act really struck me when thinking about what sacraments are a part of my religious tradition. There are only two for the UCC church, baptism and communion. And it really got me thinking about communion, where we say we are consuming Christ. We are consumers of God. So when we become consumers of the bodies of people, to me, that is sacrilegious. It is what we should not be doing. So looking at those in communication and in conversation was important to me, and which is why I have this communion table that has been set. And as I started to like make that, I recognized, oh, I want to do this with people. Like, communion has to be communal. And so I had sent an email to friends who help me hold the sacred. And I got to like sit down and paint with them. And that was so beautiful after a pandemic where I've been only creating and painting and, you know, on my own, to have this like very communal moment was so lovely. And then the rosary came from a different trip I took where I visited Majdanek, Poland, and went to a concentration camp. And there was a section where they had artwork that was made by people in the camps. And one was a rosary that someone had made out of bread. And it was so striking to me that the medium for someone who was starving would be used to make this symbol. And it seemed so connected to what actually nourishes us. And there was also a prisoner in Russia who also made a rosary of bread and ended up presenting that to the Pope. So the idea that rosaries out of bread exist and are made by people starving was so impactful to me. And so I got to sit down with a friend of mine who grew up Catholic, and we got to talk about the rosary together as we rolled bread and we rolled roses and we made a rosary together. And so to connect that to my own connection to people, but also to people who have longed for nourishment in this way, was a really a beautiful and sacred thing to partake in. And I also did some painting. So which I think the part that was like so fascinating about the painting part was this moment where I was just up to my eyeballs in my thesis and everything else that I had to finish that semester. And we had to bring in work that we had done and finished. And I brought in this painting and was like, I hate it. I'm filled with rage that I have to produce more right now. And Dr. Oz Freeman was like, yeah, you have a lot going on. Put it down and finish your thesis and then paint. And you offered me roses. Shut up, Kleenex. And I just had it sitting next to my desk until Gene Roberts was like, we need graduation artwork. And I was like, I don't have any. I have this horrible painting. But I've got an hour. And I just sat down with it in this moment where I had already finished things and had space and rest and could create and put an hour into a painting that became something I really loved and liked. So that the process of that going from something I was so angry at and was just like, stop making me produce, into I now had the space to like interact with it in a way that is life-giving and nourishing the soul. Was really lovely. And thank you. And I love you. And I love that we have tattoos together. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Elena. Catherine De La Rosa. The subtitle of our exhibit is While Catherine Knitted. And Catherine is wearing the evidence of our semester as Catherine knit this jumper throughout the whole class period beginning in February. So knitting is a time-based medium. And if you want to know what 3 or 4 months looks like, it's a great green jumper. I still remember my first conversation with Catherine when they were a prospective student. I know, okay, it was only a year ago, but you know how COVID time works. So it seems like a million years ago and also yesterday and so on. And I knew from that first conversation that Catherine is an original and creative and humorous and wicked smart artist. And of course, I'm biased towards anyone who incorporates history into their work or engages with history in their work in terms of restoring the past in constructive ways. I'm also selfishly really glad that Catherine is not graduating, is just in her first year, because we have more time together yet. So, Catherine.
That's scientifically accurate. Okay. Cool. Hi, everyone. This is going to be a weird mood whiplashy talk because, okay, I'm not going to apologize. Okay. I'm just going to start reading. Okay. This is a weird height. Oh, God. Okay. So I have the challenge of introducing halves of two plays, neither of which I expect anyone to have read by the end of this exhibit because it came out to like 150 pages, but I endeavor to do more. So that's a threat, but it didn't happen. Okay. Among Asian artists in America, I have an apparently simpler dysphoria to deal with than all of my mixed friends and heroes in a limited interior ways, in that my American Catholic school was a completely different world from my Filipino Catholic home. There was no interrace mixing at home. Sorry, not to sound okay, mid-century. Okay. But my parents met in the United States. Their hometowns are on separate islands 500 miles apart. Between them, they know four Filipino languages with only Tagalog in common because its nationalization is barely a century old. They were baptized and confirmed before Vatican II, but in dioceses descended from entirely different pre-Hispanic indigenous groups, in parishes with dramatically different wealth. The cohesion that my mixed friends dream of falls apart in a culture as heterogeneous and unnatural as the Philippines. There was no such thing as a Filipino before 1896. Before I studied Filipino history, and really before I re-met my parents as an adult, who, you know, has two liberal arts degrees in a pandemic, I live with them. I took this diversity for granted, or I took my dad's side for granted specifically. So first play, the bigger one, is a Passion play. It was initially just one act. I wrote it in the haze last Holy Week 2021. I wrote it as a fourth act, like fan fiction, to Passion Play by Sarah Rule, which is a 2008 play cycle about passions performed by Catholics in Elizabethan England, Nazi Germany, and 1980 South Dakota, which I thought was just really boring and white. And it's not her fault, whatever. Okay, so I based my first act on the Passion Play my mother grew up seeing every Friday, which really is not super unusual, where the actor playing Christ is really crucified with 4-inch nails, and then they take him down super fast and put him in an ambulance. And in this Passion Play, there's like dozens of penitents who like line up. It's like crucify me next. And they have to like have an application like screening system to be like, okay, are you a freak? But it's a serious like devotional practice for like the group of the ethnic group my mother comes from, Kabupangan. Yes, so I said it in 1970 in the aftermath of student and worker-led protests against the second inauguration of Ferdinand Marcos. But with this semester, I have dealt with like new urgency and fear. I decided a year ago when I had drafted most of Act One, I didn't think there'd be more acts, but someone prompted me to do more, so I did. Why? I did. Okay. I knew I wanted Act Two to be paternal to Act One's, you know, being about my mother's side. But in between then and now, my dad was diagnosed with cancer at Christmas. So writing this semester, I froze after a really strong start, panicking that I'd thrown away half of myself because my dad's Catholicism wasn't as weird and sexy as my mom's. And I was panicking that I'm running out of time to get to know his God while my mom will live forever out of spite. But I got over it after churning out a K-pop play. And I read more history, and then my dad started his radiation therapy in good spirits this month. And he just talks about how much his ass hurts from, they put like a rectal balloon up him. That's like the size of a dildo. He's having a horrible time. Okay. He started radiation therapy this month. So I've chilled out and like wrote most of the act two that you see like this month. Okay. So I sat in my father's home province during US rule at the turn of the 20th century. I created a less evil version of my traitor grandmother who taught English in public schools run by the American military and presumably beat children for speaking Filipino languages. So what I'm doing is I'm drawing like a tropical Gothic portrait of mestizos of every class adapting to American imperialism and the beginnings of Filipino communism with the threat of Meiji Japan on the horizon. Yeah, there's a lot of history there that I'll get into it later. So, yeah, okay. So the Philippines remains 80% Catholic, and at risk of sounding like a counter-reformer, I wish we could pause and examine what we have, which is anomaly Catholic Church with multitudes of ethnic, linguistic, and class variations across the archipelago. The only thing that unites the majority of us is Catholicism to the exclusion of a growing Protestant minority and to the repression of our Muslim countrymen and extant non-Christian indigenous groups. Since the Philippine government is an American sock puppet, it wages active war against its own people in the New People's Army and the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, which has the misfortune of being abbreviated MILF, but. I'm sorry, I respect them a lot, but I can't. Okay, for me, Filipino Catholicism is an act of revolutionary nationalism, which is distinct from American white nationalism. It is the same spirit of survival that keeps Palestinian flags flying and destroy the British Raj. I am fully aware I came to a Protestant seminary, but it's very tiny. It's like, I'm exaggerating, but there's a tiny, tiny bit of anti-Catholicism I hear in my first few classes here. And it makes me examine what conservatism really means as a philosophy and not the blanket term we use for what the seminary is not. So I read Russell Kirk, which felt disgusting. Russell Kirk coined 6 principles of conservatism, which I think defeat themselves once you take them outside of the US or just the West in general. One of them is social continuity, which, quoting him, he describes it as the means of linking generation to generation. It matters as much for society as it does for the individual. Without it, life is meaningless. For myself, not saying every Filipino has to be like this, and all of my like Filipino communist comrades are atheists. But for myself, I prefer to be one conversion away from my pre-Christian ancestors. Whatever American Protestant missionaries have to sell is only a further separation in my eyes. Okay, there's a big mood whiplash coming because the other play is stupid. Okay. So if Catholicism brings me closer to my ancestors, Filipinos tweeting in English and Tagalog about K-pop chart rankings and the Philippine presidential election with equal fervor makes me feel way more connected to the present day Philippines than speaking to my own extended family. Look at the streaming stats for any smaller groups on Spotify, and top listeners live in Indonesia, the Philippines, and Malaysia. Way before BTS, and gun to my head, I could not sing a BTS song. I really hate boy groups. Okay, K-pop's foreign market was Southeast Asia. We share a recent history of being occupied by Imperial Japan and America back to back. And these two countries exercise soft power in their former possessions via news and entertainment media. And in the US's case, continuing military occupation in both Southeast Asia and South Korea. So Hallyu, the Korean wave throughout Asia, is unusual due to South Korea's neocoloniality. Like they never had an empire, really. They just kind of quibbled with Japan here and there and then got colonized. So it's a weird relationship for them to be so huge in Southeast Asia, essentially. So a bit of very recent history. In 2021, celebrities my age in the Korean entertainment industry were hit by Me Too style accusations of past school bullying. The term in Korean is, Hagyo Bokryok, literally school violence. It started with like really serious Bobby Knight. I went to IU. Bobby Knight type abuse in the Olympic women's volleyball team, but snowballed too. I saw this TV actor throw kimchi at someone in the third grade. He should be fired. So one celebrity affected by this was in my favorite girl group, Yoja Idol, originally composed of three native Koreans and three foreigners from Thailand, China, and Taiwan. I don't presume to speak on the bullying phenomenon itself, but instead on the reaction of non-Korean, mostly white K-pop fans. If you export entertainment with such aggression, how far west can the 2,500-year-old culture that produced it really go? For Queendom, I copied Idol's composition to scale down 21st century global capitalism and post-Cold War tension to a cast of six, and threw in two English-speaking members for a little bit of Blackpink. So the eldest member in my fictional crew is a combination of Michelle's Honor of Japanese Breakfast and the memoir Crying in H-Mart, and my friends Sarah Shin and Sarah Lieber. She is a Korean Jewish American dancer with a musical theater background, more lost in South Korea's limited religious pluralism than she expected to be, because they're like kind of neatly in thirds, like Protestant, Christian, Buddhist, and nothing, so, or versions of Korean folk religion. So it's a very weird and chill place, but also very limited. And then the youngest member is literally my self-insert fanfic self, because even though Filipinos are famously karaoke gods, Korean labels only do auditions in wealthy countries, so the US, Australia, Japan, China, and Thailand. So our group's Makne is a Filipino Australian from the same town as Nick Cave, perplexed by the Catholicism practiced by her Korean unni who has been accused of bullying. So in a very messy conclusion to both of these, I think the advice to write what you know has its limits. I suspect it's a line that originally soothed suburban white dudes that they had stories to tell, but I've seen it used against non-white writers over what we are allowed. If Asian Americans, particularly the children of immigrants, only write what we know, our work never leaves the imperial core. I don't care about being represented in American culture because I should not be here. So I write about Asians in Asia, the real economic ties between Asian countries, and the religious pluralism and, I hate this word, ecumenism unique to our colonial histories. So my response to write what you know is no investigation, no right to speak, the first tenet in Mao Zedong's opposed book worship. Investigation for me is an act of love and a gesture of humility, an acknowledgement that all that I know is like silly microaggressions in liberal institutions like this seminary and every theater I've worked in, not invasion, not martial law, not red tagging, not starvation. I am not only writing what I know, I am writing what I am investigating. That's it, okay.
Great. I love that line, I'm writing what I'm investigating. Thank you, Catherine. Ariel, don't be scared. Ariel Johnson. Don't let Ariel's buoyant positivity and genuine kindness and good humor fool you. She is a serious person who has serious talent and works her ass off in all realms, not just here at the seminary, professionally, everywhere, personally. Ariel, you bring deep theological thinking and care to your ministry, and you have dealt with and overcome a lot, yes, this year and in the last several years To be frank, I am in awe of how you have made it through this time, that you have not only survived but thrived, that you have continually prioritized your work here at the seminary, but you've also cared for yourself and made tough choices. And I think that gives me great encouragement for you leading a healthy and happy and thriving life when you get out of the insanity that is seminary. So thank you. It's been just a joy to work with you over the last several years.
This is the coolest thing I've ever gotten in my life. I am, and is it like a cougar or is it a panther? I don't know. It's a big cat. It's very cool. So I know that Dr. S. Freeman gave a little bit of an introduction about me, but I should also inform you that my full-time day job, whatever you want to call it, is I'm the director of children and family ministries at a church here in Minneapolis. And that's very important because I'm about to talk about children for a long time. Which also there's no children in my project. So just bear with me. So I know that this is supposed to be an opportunity for me to tell you all about my art and this cool project I did. But I would be remiss if I didn't talk to you about this show that I just saw this week, two nights ago. So I went to a performance called Encore, which is a musical review that features various genres of music, and it's put into a theme. This particular theme was Party in the USA, which did include the Miley Cyrus song, and yes, it was very fun. It was put on by Egan High School, and I attended because I knew that I had a student in the show whom I had worked with and did voice lessons to, and so she said, "Can you come?" And I was like, "Of course I can come." So I went. And it turned out that I actually knew four students in the show. Two of them were high schoolers and two of them were in elementary school. And everything about this particular production was students. So there was student performers, they both singers and dancers. There was a jazz band that was made up of all students other than director. The run crew was students, the stage manager was students. Everybody was students, except for this design team. And I have to tell you, it was absolutely phenomenal. I am still floored. I am flabbergasted. I am at a loss for words. I told literally everyone that I saw leaving, who I called, some of you on my Facebook, it was better than Broadway tours that I have seen. And that is high praise because I've seen Rent, and let me tell you, whoo, so good. And all I could feel was pride. These students were ones I had taught since they were like little babies, which also, how am I old enough that there's little babies that are now in high school? I don't know, but it's a thing. And one of these students was he had a featured dance solo, and I hadn't seen him for 5 years. I cried when I saw him. Ooh, so good. So another one of them had multiple singing solos, and then the two elementary students just rocked their hearts out as they danced and they sang. And in fact, it wasn't just my students, but every single student on that stage had managed to impress me beyond belief. And the message that they sang with the variety of music, it was inspiring. And two of these song selections were all female, and they had very, very powerful messages behind it. They did Down to the River to Pray, an all female ensemble, and then they did Kings and Queens by Ava Marx, right? Yeah, she's cool. It's a really good song. Go listen to it. And so I was sitting there and I was by myself in the audience and I was watching and listening to these selections. And then I realized that's why I do what I do. Do you know how powerful it is to watch a group of young women lifting up their voices and singing on stage? Watching them unite together. They're young women of different ages and races, sexualities, body types. And they were singing and banding together, and they promoted messages of peace and unity. And I got to hear them take a stand and sing boldly and proudly. But they were united and they were building each other up instead of tearing each other apart. And for a few minutes, all of the drama of high school and who got the solos and who was getting the dance stuff, that was all behind them. They just united together and presented something so moving that I could not stop smiling the entire duration of both acts and the intermission, and the mom sitting right next to me thought I was freaking nuts. Luckily, her friend liked me. That was good. That was helpful. But I realized as I was sitting there, that is why I do art. I can't not do art without my students. They inspire me daily. They inspire to me to make the art, to live art, to breathe the art, and to be art. I started off with this semester thinking about how I was going to use the class to reclaim my artistry, to learn how to make space and promote my voice and my talents, my own ideas and creativity. Because after all, to be an artist is to make art and to be proud of one's work. But halfway through, when I was listening to all the songs and doing my research, I realized that while I do sing, and I love it, I'm the kind of artist who wants to lift up others. I'm the kind of artist who wants to inspire others and to teach them, to teach others the skills to make great work. And so therefore, my project could not just be me. It couldn't be the me show. I already did a me show in my college and my undergrad at my senior recital. So this instead needed to be something that would not only lift me up, but lift others up and give us life, give us something to do after the craziness of everything. But above all, I knew I needed to lift up the voices of women. You know, I really didn't realize when I came into seminary that I was going to so strongly embrace what it means to be a feminist and to have the feminist lens as I became a theologian. But now I can't imagine doing art or talking about the Bible without it. And I realize that might seem a little bit bizarre because I'm a cis female and all, but in my previous studies and thoughts, and as a children's director, I spend way more time thinking about how to talk about Jesus and all the people around Jesus and spreading the words about Jesus and doing Jesus and walking the words and ways of Jesus than any of the other characters in the Bible. So I discovered that my next step for my project was to find the other parts of the Bible that I was passionate about. And Esther, being my call story, provided an easy place for me to start my focus. And then from there, I trusted the process, and each new woman I encountered, studied, and read came to life. And then it was just a matter of choosing what resonated to me most and which told the best story, because some of them are good and some of them are, oh, all right, whatever. So in my project, I was able to think about and reclaim these stories that were written by men about women. And with the help of my colleagues, both those present in this room and those who are involved in my project, we turned them into stories written by women, about women, and for women. And like the students who inspire me with their strong presences, I was inspired to bring a new light to these amazing women who I felt just do not get enough credit or who get overshadowed because there's a man at the center of their story. And while some of those characters came easily to me, others I got to discover through research and learn more about. And did you know it's amazing the things you can discover when you actually do research and read other people's work? Let me tell you what I wish I'd known when I was young and dreamed of glory. You have no control who lives, who dies, who tells your story. Except, I learned that I can do that. But it takes the help of others, looking at all of you, to share those stories in their truest nature. So I hope that those of you here and online, thank you for joining us online, folks. Great to see you. I hope that when you listen to my project, Reclaimed, that you get a chance to. And when you do, that you really, truly open up your mind and your heart and your ears to hear these stories and then go tell them. Tell them everywhere. Tell them how strong and faith-filled these women were, how independent and good and righteous they were, how they lifted each other up and walked with the Creator to pave the way for future generations. And then help me and come with me and go see my students. Because they're the future and they're the future of art. And I cannot do it without them. Thank you.
that's such a nice also articulation of how I feel about my students. We're going to pause here, and I didn't even mention your incredible managerial skills with stage managing, so I blew right past that. We're going to pause here for a little break of refreshments for those of us who are in person and online. Fluid adjustment break, as I like to refer to that in class, keeping it classy. So let's do a cool 7 minutes. That's a United 10, probably. Yep. Okay. And so enjoy some refreshments. And we'll be back at, what's that, 8:13 Central Time. No. Welcome back to those who are back. You're gonna wanna listen up for this next one. Fred Keepers is our next artist. He's a true artist. What can I say about Fred? On Zoom calls, Fred unmutes himself to laugh and then mutes himself again. That's correct. He will unmute himself to laugh and then mute again. And that tells you most of what you need to know about Fred. Fred is someone who freely shares his good humor and his joy with the community. He is a daydreamer and a storyteller. His stories are contained in his twinkling eyes and in the folder in the gallery. So you should check that out. And in true Fred style, humble to the end, he had the gall to print a one-page sample so folks wouldn't have to go to the bother of opening the whole thing and reading his work. So I hope you'll disabuse him of that idea and read the whole thing out of spite. Fred, on behalf of myself and the Arts Practicum cohort, you are an artist. Thank you for sharing your art with us. You're the number one dad.
I don't have any visuals, and kind of makes you feel inadequate. But I do have to mention something that Matthew's piece is called Letters to an Unknown God, and he mentions in it the sublime moments he has. It's like he's on my shoulder. I didn't know what he had done. So you'll probably hear a few echoes, but we start. I'm a student in a master's program titled Theology and the Arts, but I am also a wanderer searching for theology in the arts. This is not to say that there's an absolute in art. To say that implies a limit, an end, and that there's nothing more to say. A word bandied about in artist circles and departments of philosophy is sublime. Weakly defined as or compared to beauty, there is something more in the sublime. The sublime is infinite, unparalleled, an elevation of the spirit, the experience of the object, not the object. For me, the sublime is an imaginative pursuit. And the pursuit does not necessarily follow a straight path. More often than not, I stumble over connections, half-exposed roots, tangled vines that throw me in an entirely different direction. I wander in my imagination, and it may be best if I attempt an illustration, a small story. It's at this time we usually warn the young people. Strap in, kids. Dad's taking you for a ride. I'd ask you to think about the first great human idea. The development of stone tools is widely regarded as the first important breakthrough. But if we travel back further, we can find an idea that might be hypothetical, but far more compelling. Our ancestors had the first great idea when they stood up, the idea of bipedalism. Standing up frees the hands. We make tools, we make art. The larynx descends and lies lower in the throat, a better position to form vowels and consonants, the foundations of language. Bipedalism changed our pattern of breathing, leading to an improvement in the quality and variety of sounds. We sing. To walk efficiently, the female pelvis became smaller. Born with a smaller brain, our young required a longer period to develop. So began the formation of families, larger groups, and complex social structures. And it is with the advent of these social structures that we developed consciousness, a sense of self. The sense of self entails looking inward to understand that which is outward. And it is a cosmic irony that we became aware of ourself only to lose it in the pure joys of the imagination. Now, when my ancestor stood up, she saw the horizon, a horizon so vast that she had to turn her head in both directions to take it all in. There was endless sky above and limitless savanna below. My ancestor looked out on the vast expanse and thought, there's more there. We'll call her Gertrude Stone. The biblical writers say that early on the second day, God separated the waters above and below. The Lord made the first horizon because the Lord needed the horizon. It has been said that without it, we cannot learn, but I would add that without one, we might not dream. One day, Gertrude sat at a stream, weaving a basket from the long grasses. Her hands worked with a knowledge of their own, and in her reverie, her eyes fell on the footprints of predators, people, and other prey that had hardened into the dried clay away from the stream. If she'd poured water into these prints, it did not soak readily into the ground. The prints held the water much better than her grass basket. So Gertrude lined the inside of her basket with wet clay from the stream and dried it in the savannah sun. She had made a pot, and with it, she could carry more water to the group with fewer trips, and she could use the pot more than once. She taught others, and soon the tribe had pots and bowls for berries, seeds, herbs, anything that wouldn't fit in their pockets. There were particular pots that Gertrude especially liked, just by the softness of their shape and silhouette. They gave her a sense of herself, and she would mark these with a line, a fingerprint, or her whole hand so as not to lose them. One day she found a different color of clay, and after the pot dried, she added this new clay to the surface, marking it further. She found rocks of different colors. When she crushed them and spit into them, yellows, ochres, browns, and rust reds could be smeared on the pots and bowls. Soon Gertrude was finding more pleasure in what was on the pot than what was in it. She began adding her designs to pieces of dead wood, bark, and slabs of smooth stone. She drew the line of the horizon, the windings of the stream, the images of animals that were eaten and those that ate. These pieces she took to her house in the village and hung them on the walls. These would not be lost. It was one particular day, as a cool shade and a soft breeze held back the savannah heat and the baby slept, Gertrude looked into herself, found something, and painted her gods. Known to her, but to no others, she arranged them on a high table with a spray of flowers, a bone, and a flicker of flame. When Gertrude died, her sons took the house. They threw the doors open so that all the people of the town could enter, marvel, maybe dream. And the sons charged admission. There it is, from Lucy to the Louvre in a paragraph. When the town marveled at Gertrude's art, were they in fact approaching unknown gods? Is this the sublime? I found my own definition in an unlikely source. Harold Bloom, literary critic, scholar, educator, and most notably, a staunch and distinctly unapologetic defender of the white male English language writers of the Western canon. Oh yeah, he wrote in The Anatomy of Influence. I keep urging the work of the reader sublime. Confront only those writers who are capable of giving you a sense of something ever more about to be. Something ever more about to be. Laid low and lifted high. I thought, damn, that crusty old atheist just described God. God the sublime. In those few words, he defined my own spiritual search, the reach without the grasp, the question nested in every waking prayer. At the risk of some embarrassment, I admit that I Googled Bloom's phrase. Someone must have been as equally moved. The phrase appears word for word in William Wordsworth's autobiographical poem, The Prelude. In his book, Bloom gives no attribution to Wordsworth as the author of the phrase. But a greater surprise and much more pleasantly relevant is the stanza in which the line appears. I close with the words from book six of The Prelude. Note its beginning and where the poem takes us. Imagination. Here the power so called through incompetence of human speech. That awful power rose from the mind's abyss like an unfathered vapor that enwraps at once some lowly traveler. I was lost, halted without an effort to break through. But to my conscious soul, I now can say, I recognize thy glory. In such strength of usurpation, when the light of sense goes out, but with a flash that has revealed the invisible world, doth graceness make abode their harbors. Whether we be young or old, our destiny, our being's heart and home, is with infinitude. And only there, with hope it is, hope that can never die, effort and expectation and desire, and something ever more about to be. Thank you.
Isabel. I mentioned at the outset that this semester has been raw and beautiful in many ways. And Isabel really helped to set the tone for that in our class. I mean that in the best way possible. In terms of her vulnerability and authenticity from literally the very first class meeting, and your classmates met you there and held you there. And we have, I think, in turn, done that for one another over the course of the entire semester, including this weekend, which is why I'm still reeling from the news of Matthew's death. I guess I wasn't afraid to be here. In fact, I was relieved that we would be together tonight, and just grateful to be in the space with you all So thank you, Isabel. Thank you for helping us be human together. The work that you have created and will speak to us about comes from this deep, deep earthy place. And it's, I think, amazing how the juxtaposition of the animal imagery that you use gets at something so human, right? And so vulnerable. And to speak personally, it resonates with me in this way that still astounds me in a very embodied kind of way that I don't quite yet have words for, but I don't have to because you wrote them for me. So thank you. Please come up.
Receive your reward.
Great. So I'm a crier. This was actually for me. Just anticipating. Because you know what's really vulnerable is talking about your art. and what's probably even more vulnerable is talking about your art in personal theological terms. So here we go. I might cry, but don't worry about me. It's just sort of how I move through the world. All right. Through this creative process, I have come to a personal framing of the sacred as deep story. Though this particular language is recent for me, this understanding has its roots in my childhood, in the way back, as long as I can remember, in the ways in which listening to and telling stories has always been where I feel myself most guided, into the beautiful mess of humanity, into what it means to be connected and awake and alive. The sacred as deep story can be found manifested, not exclusively, but certainly in the old stories, fairy tales, folklore, myths, stories that move us, that inspire wonder, the stories that stick with us on our skin and in our bones, stories that are wild. Intertwined with the idea of the sacred as deep story, I've been drawn to the concept and embodiment of God as wild self, as deep knowing. There has been a narrative for generations used pointedly in the service of white supremacy and white supremacy culture, not to mention heteropatriarchy, that to be civilized is to know God, and in turn, a narrative of God as civilizing force. This picture of God I find small and sad and harmful. In response, I sing a God of wildness, of rewilding, of howling from gut and groin, of the active quiet of the deep woods, of muscle joy and raucous play, of the still holiness of a sky alight with stars. I find this God, this sacred, this divine, expressed in nature and in our oldest stories, where women turn to swans or seals or wolves and back again, where trees speak and mountains split open and magic abounds and healing is inevitable. So, with that framing to my piece and my approach, as an artist, my training, background, and experience is primarily in devised theater. Myself and members of my artistic family, the theater ensemble I co-founded in 2010 called Transatlantic Love Affair, will gather around the kernel of a story, usually a fairy tale or folktale, and over the course of several weeks, we'll together in deep collaboration build a play. It requires trust and wrestling and flexibility. I am glad to share that there's never any shortage of laughter. I have often gravitated to the director's role in these processes, bringing forth the seed of the idea from which we will draw and a vision for both the process and the finished product. And I love this exercise of working in collaboration. It is an embodied practice of building community, of making shared meaning, of providing an offering for the wider world about our observations around a deep and human truth. In these ways, our work as devised theater artists is deeply theological. And yet in approaching this process, I knew quite early on I would not be helming a collaboratively created theater piece this semester. There are practical reasons for this, not the least of which being the restrictions placed on physical collaborative artistic processes due to COVID. But I also saw in this charge of the personal creative project the invitation to listen deeply to my own artistic voice, to lean into the color and texture that feels particular to what I bring. As all good challenges are, I found this invitation both exhilarating and terrifying. I have often struggled in collaborative processes to fully trust my own voice, to find the balance between holding a space where all can bring their particular talents and ideas and contributions and fully offering my own perspective as well. What would reveal itself if the voice I was most concerned with was my own? The result in this moment is the narrative you will find there in poem form. Though in no way literal, it is deeply personal. As I, in these past months, am walking a path of grief, hope, and transformation. I'm going to go off script for a moment here because there was a class period where I did this. I like burst into tears and was like, it's so personal. What if it doesn't make sense to anybody? And it was Matthew who said, nope, that means you're on the right track. So thank you, Matthew. So it is deeply personal, but it is also completely transposed, utilizing elements of old and ancestral stories, those fairy tales, witchy inclinations, wolf stories, wild woman yarns. The threads that have woven themselves together in inspiration of this narrative are old Celtic and Irish stories from my own ethnic ancestry, particularly the folklore of wolf walkers, as beautifully rendered in the recent animated film of that name. Go see it if you have not. And stories of the pre-Christian triune goddess Bridget, mother of Keening, as well as my own deep kinship with the woods and a healthy dose of Red Riding Hood for good measure. These are stories I recognize in what has been birthed in my piece, and I am curious what you may see in your engagement with it. There were so many ways these poems, this narrative could have been displayed or shared as part of tonight's presentation. I considered visual, architectural, and experiential elements before finally settling on oral tradition, the oldest form of storytelling, and for access and to honor the way the story first manifested itself to me, I have provided it in written form as well, with moss and bark, because I couldn't help myself. And here I have a confession to make from my drama dork heart. I don't know if it works. The story in this format, I wrote it as a story to be told, as a story to be given from body to body in space, humming with words and silence and spirit. As a theater artist, it feels at times that this, more than anything, is my medium, the electricity that is felt in performance when I use all of my body and spirit and self to tell the story, and you respond in turn to listen with the fullness of your body, spirit, self. And in this way, we co-create the narrative, even a new reality, together. This is storytelling as the original call and response. And I will admit that I have some uncertainty about whether the heart of this thing, this story that spilled through me, whether it fully translates to the page or to the audio file. But this too is part of both art and theology. The leap of faith, the hoping, the not quite sure, the offering of the whole heart anyway. As much as I've taken this process as a call to listen closely to my own artistic impulses, this was not a solo effort. Nothing ever is. Certainly, I've been held by my community, beloveds, friends, colleagues, classmates, my beautiful, amazing classmates in this journey. But I've also experienced this creative process as a collaboration with spirit. With spirit and with this, here it comes. With spirit and with the still small voice within, which told me the story I needed to hear. And I needed to embody, and I needed to move through in this threshold moment of grief and transition in my own life.
And this experience has only reinforced what I know to be true. That these stories, the old stories, know the way to the sacred. They point us home. They lead us deep within, closer to ourselves, to each other, remind us of our residence in the web of speaking and non-speaking life, many-legged and winged. How can this not bring us closer to all that is holy, all that is true? Blessed are the stories that celebrate the particular and the universal at once. Blessed are the stories that call us home to ourselves and to each other. Sacred are the stories we share. Thank you. Oof.
That makes me think the reading that you did of those poems, the poems that you had in class that day, maybe is, that is it. I'm sorry you all weren't there, but we were all holding our breath. Stephanie. When we were deciding our order. Stephanie wasn't there that day, and so we assigned her to be last. Yeah. So those who are last shall be first. It's been so much fun for me as a medievalist to selfishly introduce you to medieval sources and imagery that I know you will gobble up and engage with. And so indeed, you can see the side wound of Jesus, aka the vulva of Jesus, in the gallery. We can talk more about that if you have questions. And to witness your development as a multimedia artist, especially in sculpture, where you have the most fun, I think, or built environments maybe, as an activist, as a theologian. One of the things that I so appreciate about you is that your ability to engage with great nuance, engage your materials with great nuance, so that you can, I think, encounter a text, an image, an object, a person, whatever, where they are, understand that. This is me as the historian speaking, I guess, is what I'm saying. and find something really, you find that seed. So Stephanie's been doing a lot of nesting this semester, which you'll probably hear about. And we've had a lot of gestures like this, and there's a lot of seedy fermentation. Something is growing. We've been listening to Tom Waits. What's he building in there is kind of one of the influences for this. And for that reason too, I mean, the lineup of this, the last group, you'll notice with what care we've curated this program, going from Fred's story to Isabel's story to Stephanie's, that they share a ground, I suppose, if we're gonna stick with that metaphor. And it is for that reason, I'm not cheating, but it is for that reason that you also get, great job, risk taker. Because you and Isabel have been likewise taking some risks with your medium and digging into this earthy ground, planting seeds, and you don't know what will come up. But I'm so excited for what came up out of that ground for you. So great job, risk taker. Come up and tell us about it.
Oh, oofta. All right, I've got visuals, so I'm gonna set this up here. Yeah, and you'll probably hear a lot of similarities between, thank you, Catherine, between Isabel's talk and work and mine, even though they manifested very differently. Okay. So my work is entitled Becoming Home. And I know that I am in a room full of storytellers and people who understand stories, as well as historians. So you all will understand that, like any story, the story of this body of work and these pieces can start and end in many, many, many different places. But today, like Ariel, I decided that this story needed to start and end with some children who have inspired me, two nine-year-olds to be specific, who I considered to really be the masterminds behind this art. So the first, I'll introduce you to Ella. She is my friend, my dear friend, Laura's daughter, who I am Auntie Stephanie to, and is honestly my favorite creative collaborator. I will say more about her contributions later. The second is this one. This is nine-year-old Stephanie, who, like in this picture, spent hours spinning worlds, daydreaming, spinning strange stories from household objects and sticky flowers, collecting colorful bottles and old photos from neighbors' garage sales, some of which still live in boxes in my parents' houses, sorry. And doing what I can only describe as communing with the image realm. Doing art for me didn't feel like a separate act, but an inevitable spilling over. In the recent film, Strawberry Mansion, Arabella, pictured here, is asked by a tax auditor who visits her to provide her current profession. She answers, "Oh dear, I never really know how to answer this. Recently I've been painting, oh, I'd love to show you some. And I'm always writing. I've been currently working on a short story about an astronaut who falls in love with a supernova. And of course I've been composing songs for many years and constructing various machines and gadgets. I think of myself as something of an atmosphere creator." Auditor then smirks, camera cuts to a close-up of him writing in on other on his form, artist. So like Arabella, I did not need to identify as an artist. I was living as one. Not in the sense that I was exceptionally talented, but in that I was constantly and perhaps compulsively creating and connecting. Thank you, Mom and Dad, for sending me these lovely images of some of those creations. Later, this connection-seeking creativity also felt very much at home in prayer and ritual and church. Even later at art museums and in dance classes, I was drawn to all spaces that gave permission to slow down, think deep, and feel big. To seek a sensation of something more. We might call this sensation sacred. While I found spiritual belonging and aliveness in many of these different pockets, as I grew older, I felt a growing sense of separation. I started to feel that the part of me who loved daydreaming and dancing, the part of me who loved biology and books, and the part of me who got turned on by mosses and loved the Eucharist, all had to stay in their separate rooms, not to mingle or mess each other up. Here's the gesture. Like many of us sensitive creatures, I swallowed this story that my creativity was too weird, too messy, and too much. But even as that message nestled itself inside of me, there was this haunting of a memory that this separation hadn't always been true and might not actually be real. And that paradoxically, I was actually not alone in feeling that separation from myself and from the wild world. This is where the questions underlying my art began to form. How can we repair this separation? How can we remember how to inhabit relationships and this wild world more fully? So as an undergraduate, this led me to pursue environmental biology. And as an undergraduate, my favorite classes were botany classes, which might be evident in my work. And I had one professor, my botany professor, who every time she talked about photosynthesis, which was a lot in this class, she would get goosebumps. And she would get this grin on her face and exclaim to us, "Isn't this amazing?" As though she were relaying miracle stories or had seen an apparition of Mary. And I remember thinking, yes, that's it. I feel that too. Photosynthesis is not just this, which is amazing, but it's also this and this and this. Those goosebumps tell a fuller story. There's the molecular and chemical interactions, but it's also the magic of making food, of transforming life. The story of tomatoes and algae and arousal and sun. Those goosebumps for a whole earth story led me to work on a farm after school and later for wetlands protection, and then as a sex educator, and then for a neuroscience research center and mindfulness center. And in many ways, I think I was trying to repair that story. I was trying to fill in this fuller picture of the ecosystems that I loved. And it was really that project of repair that led me here to United. Serene Jones, a theologian, describes theology, which here at UTS, and especially in this space we know is synonymous with art, that the place and story you think of when you ask yourself about the meaning of your life, the world, and the possibility of God. I'll add to this definition, of course, that art and theology are also about the relationships, as an ecologist, I gotta say this, that we have to those places and stories. And I think as I'm learning here at United, it's also about the relationship that our stories have to other people's stories. So my art comes from this process of revealing, of reconciling and repairing those storied relationships. As Donna Haraway says, staying with the trouble. Through assemblage of material I've collected from walks in the woods, along the Mississippi River, the streets in my neighborhood, or the reservoir of my co-op's basement, I repurpose, which is pictured there, hence the Tom Waits reference, it's me in the basement. I repurpose and remix to discover possibilities of new relationships between ordinary things. As Catherine Keller writes in her book, Facing Apocalypse, it's not about making all new things, but about making all things new. This art is an apocalyptic practice of peeling off deeper and deeper layers of truth and keeping the skins, and then drying them out in the sun, kissing them tenderly, mixing them with some of my friend Peregrine's hair, and affixing them with saliva and river water to make a nest. This art is me inviting you to walk through the woods with me and stop at every other or maybe every mound of glistening green moss and pocked orange lichen to boop them and look for the possibility of God in the smallest beings. Influenced heavily by the spiritual abstraction of Hilma af Klint and the ecosexual movement of Annie Sprinkle and Beth Stevens, this way of seeing the natural world and ourselves is akin to Catherine Keller's methodology of dream reading scripture, a kind of dream reading the material world. In other words, letting ourselves get goosebumps about it. And so here, maybe, there we go, oop. So here are some visuals for those who are virtual. Microcosmos, is a reflection of our origin stories, as well as the irresistible urge to sew many little circles. Sorry, Ariel. Sorry, other people who don't like little circles. And here's Peregrine's hair. Credit to Peregrine here for your contributions. So in this work, I mingle biologist and theorist Lynn Margulis and her concept of sympoiesis, which is that evolution happened through symbiotic relationships instead of competition, as well as an erotic dream reading of Genesis. In this celebration of play and pleasure of creation, the ambiguity of these shapes invites a kind of dream reading from the viewer as well, a conjuring of a spilling over of images that could be cells, bodies, parts, and whole moving across a white void. In this second series of work, Contamination, really complicating the purity of what is natural versus unnatural and artificial, especially within the white-led environmental movement and other dominant paradigms. It's also about getting unapologetically devotional about indecent incarnational bits. The final series, Nested. Nope, coming, it's coming. Was actually the first that I made. The series was inspired by nesting practices of paper wasps, beavers, and birds. And it also brings us back to my other 9-year-old collaborator. Let's see if it gets us there. Yeah. There we go. So on a late summer afternoon, about a year ago, my sister Audrey and I were with my friend Laura and her daughter Ella, and we were lounging on the shore of Salmo Pond, which is a watering hole just outside of Madison, Wisconsin, and one of our favorite places. We had just gone for a dip, and we were spread out on a blanket, letting the blazing hot rays lick up the cool drops of water from our skin. Ella smiled at me and rolled over closer and looked down at me and my armpit, which was exposed in my reclined position. She giggled and pointed at the tufts of hair there, saying, "Auntie Stephanie, you have nests in your armpit." In that intimate, playful moment, she transformed the image of my body hair forever. In that moment, she also conjured a deep home sensation, a sense that I am a home, to imaginary birds and likely quite a few real bacteria. I'm a home to her and a home to me. My hope is that what I made from this story might help you to look at an inch a little bit closer to yourself and your wild world, and maybe even find the sensation that you are home to. Thank you. Since I'm up here, I'm just gonna take another minute, even though I'm over my minutes. First, I wanna say a couple of thank yous. One to Matthew, who, as many other people have mentioned, has echoes through all of our work and our process. I think he was just a very encouraging presence in our class, especially as someone who had a lot of experience as a studio artist and held us through, for some of us, what was very unfamiliar terrain. And in some ways, that was like sending poems to the chat that he had written from his one-a-days in moments where we were wrestling with something. In other ways, very practical. I saw Matthew on Wednesday when we were installing our art. And I don't think my art would be on the walls and look the way that it does if he wasn't here. being the first time I had done that, he was like, "Oh, I know the tricks. You need this and this and this." So just a lot of gratitude to him, and he's very much present here. My other gratitude is to our professor, Dr. Oz Freeman. Who very much, as we have been mentioning, created a safe place where we could recover a sense of pleasure and play in the creative process, and also know that the creative process includes loss and all of the hard moments, and really just allowed us all to spill over when we needed to do that and create art from that real place. Very much a midwife to our beautiful mess. I'm very grateful. And I actually brought a little award for you also. This is, I hope you will accept, a token of gratitude. This is sacred goo, which Matthew, I think, would also appreciate. This is a symbol of the patience that you had with all of our messiness and silliness. We, so the other subtitle of this show, other alternative name, is Goo, which we sincerely thought we were going to name it. And Jennifer the whole time was like, of course, we can do whatever you want. Very supportive. It all worked out. But yes, this is for you, Jennifer. Thank you. Thank you.
Elena made me aware of a wonderful quote of Matthew's from a few years past. Matthew once said, "I hate preachy art. That sort of saccharine sweet art makes my teeth hurt. I want God to be in my art, but it took me years to figure out how to do that. Now I get to continue to play with the idea of how to do Christian art on the sly." You maybe can see that when you walk through the hallway. Zoom folks, stay tuned for our blog version of the exhibit. Okay. So I've only known Matthew for a year. I wear these overalls in his honor, as I said, and I think I will be wearing them more frequently from here on out. And I invite you to do likewise. Go and do likewise. They're so practical and comfortable. But we've all benefited in this class from Matthew's deep wisdom as an artist, his experience, from practical things to theoretical, to his really kind of just childlike enthusiasm and wonder at the process. I'm somebody who's always harping on about process, but I think Matthew really lived that out. Was so also aware of his process, entered the studio with wonder, had a very committed practice. And I think for him, that practice was a lifeline in many ways in his own journey, in his faith journey and in his life. And I think it is such an amazing testament to the power of art in our lives. And he was really a guide in our class, as Stephanie just said. I love that image of overflowing, this abundance kind of spilling out, and his enthusiasm, whether, you know, sharing that in class or in the chat, you know, there was always kind of like a parallel conversation happening in the chat on Zoom of Matthew just sharing these things. And yes. And so there's not words for the loss of this. So what I'll do is I'll share, if I can do it, one of Matthew's poems by way of conclusion to this portion, and then I'll invite our musicians to come up and close out this portion with a song. And then we'll have time for a conversation. We can also feel how that feels for you all. It's a long program because we have this wonderful large class of students. So we can see how that feels. But Matthew, in the exhibit, I should say too, are a series of poems that are meant to accompany the images. There's great space between each of those paintings because Matthew had taken home his poems to mount them so that he could come back and install them. So I don't know which poems go with which paintings, but he might enjoy you trying to figure that out, I think. So you can take the binder and wander about and decide for yourself. And he was, was an established visual artist. Poetry was something that I think was still a very vulnerable place for him. And he expressed to me on multiple occasions, feeling like an imposter when it came to poetry. And so I think also such a great model for us. And even those places where we feel established, there are always those growing edges and the bravery that he had in putting his poetry out there for us. And so that's why it's included in the folder. Okay, enough of me. Let's hear from Matthew. Most times, I remember the gift and the giving, the you, the me, the us, trudging together through this wild and treasured life. The unknown freedom I found in the space you provided, the welcome, acceptance, and unconditional belonging still bids my heart to rise and lifts my soul high into a hope-filled sky of what has become and may come. Gratefulness blooms like the small tender flowers that burst from the limbs of the pink dogwood trees rooted deeply in the nutrient-rich ground of my backyard. Those trees have endured through long dark days and cold winter nights, somehow knowing that spring will come and the sun will shine again. Sometimes when life gets hard and that cold winter of darkness seems to forever go on and I feel all alone, I lose sight of the treasures of welcome and love, of belonging and joy, of the peace I have made with myself. Thank God I have planted my roots deep in the ground of a community that remembers when I don't, reminds when I forget, believes when I doubt that we are all the beloved.
Is it the wind over my shoulder? Is it the wind that I hear gently whispering? Are you alone here in the valley? No, not alone, for you walk with me. Is it the wind there over my shoulder? Is it your voice calling quietly over the hilltop down in the valley? Never alone, for you walk with me. When evening falls and the air gets colder, when shadows cover the road I am following, will I be alone? there in the darkness. No, not alone, not alone, and I'll never be.
Never alone, you are walking, you're walking with me.
Is it the wind there over my shoulder? Is it your voice calling quietly over the hilltop, down in the valley? Never alone, for you walk with me.
Thank you, Dustin and Ariel and Jeffrey. Thank you, everyone. I would love if we could give some time to our artists to come up. I'm looking at you. Would you do me the honor, Elena Hoffman? Okay, thanks. And others?
Can I share a quote from Matthew?
Yeah, please. Something I remembered while Isabel was talking was when we were like talking in class about like, oh, is this good? Is this good? Something that Matthew passed on to us from someone else was, your job is not to be the best in the room. Your job is to be the most honest. So.
Good one.
Yeah. Friends, if you have any questions, comments, also, I'd like to open it up to our artists. Likewise, if there is anything that you'd like to share or ask of your colleagues, there's also a microphone in the back we can grab too for the audience. Thanks, Grace. This will take a minute. Just talk. Got it?
Yep.
Max? Yep. Can always count on Max to get us started.
Amazing work, everyone, and it was really exciting. I've met with you all at the beginning, early on of your journey, and just seeing where the art has gone, how you've developed your voices, even in a few months, is remarkable. So thank you for doing all that work. It really benefits everyone, everyone here, and everyone who will engage your art. I have a specific question for Stephanie, and then other people, I think, feel free to add too. And this is because I'm a little bit more familiar with Stephanie's work, but it's sort of this idea of story and relationship. And I know that, Stephanie, you've done a lot of work around how do we talk with Indigenous stories? How do you talk about the complex stories of violence and colonization? And I think this has a lot to do with Catherine's project. It has a lot to do with several projects. But one of the things that I'm thinking of is you've done a paper on not destroying problematic art or not taking it down. Not that that's necessarily wrong, but about transformation and story. So I'm curious a little bit about more depth or a little more explanation about what relationship is in story, especially with really hard stories. So inspired by Stephanie's work, but I do think that it really could be answered by a number of you. So how do you be in relationship with some of the more difficult, more challenging, more violent stories?
Yeah, you need to come. You need to come over here.
Okay.
Thanks, Max. I've lost my little thing. Yeah, I think that, you know, I started my talk by saying the story of this work could start in many different places. Which is true of history also. I think I could have very much started talking about this work with some of my experiences last summer, which many of you know was sort of the underlying stuff I was working through in this body of work. So last summer, I mentioned that I've been involved as an environmental biologist. I've been involved in a lot of environmental activism and have worked for nonprofits, white-led nonprofits doing that work. And my spiritual lineage is also with transcendentalism, intersectioning with Unitarian Universalism, which is also about relationship to nature, but very much white colonial bodies and their relationship to land. And that's where I come in. And that's where my ancestry is. And I think that I've always known that there was something missing, like I was alluding to in my talk, and feeling this sense of sacred, but that there was something between my body and the land that I still needed to reconcile, and I'm still doing that. And this last summer, I got involved in an indigenous-led environmental campaign to stop the pipeline in northern so-called Minnesota. And I think I remember, you know, the beginning of what is still a building relationship with Indigenous history and Indigenous people who are still here, and reconciling that story with my story started through an invitation from one of the elders who stood up. And before we got into like tactics of like our strategies for the direct action and all of that, it's like, first we need to start with a history. And he looked at us and he was like, you know, a lot of white folks there gathered around, including me, was like, before we move forward, we have to look backward. And don't be afraid to look backward. We all come from somewhere. And I think it wasn't until that very generous invitation from a place of love and desire for healing that I was able to kind of start making this work and touch it and engage with these things. And I don't really know how to explain that, but I think it is through beginning to have those hard truths and conversations about how my history is of people who love land and nature and came from a place, and the ways that that was taken from other people. So I think it's from that, those complicated, uncomfortable spaces where I was actually able to make something that felt real and authentic. So that's my answer. Does anyone else?
Okay, the really simple answer that I would have given when I was like 18 is that Christianity in the Philippines is violence. Its introduction was violent. The introduction of what we recognize as Western theater in the Philippines was Jesuits bringing very violent teaching plays to the indigenous Filipinos to convert them. They would make them burn their folk religion symbols while performing plays about Jesus as like a point against paganism. So I think that the impulse behind cultural revolutions and like atheism and state atheism is like looking at the violence of Christianity and like Christian cultures and saying we have to get rid of it. Like it's the evil thing. It's the thing that has been used to exploit the poor and the colonized forever. So we have to get rid of it. But I think what that does is that only looks at like, I guess like the high church of like in the Philippines, it would have been like friars from Spain who are white. They are white friars coming over to the Philippines, teaching people, forcing people to learn Spanish. It's only looking to the high places and not looking at these mestizo Filipinos who have brown skin and indigenous ancestry, plus a lot of Chinese, plus like some Spanish, and what they have done with the Bible itself and the Christianity that my ancestors have made for themselves. Like I think that knee-jerk anti-theism in like leftist spaces is like the big reason I'm here. Like I was like a very good and like believing Catholic until I was like in the, it's very neat with my education. So until like the eighth grade, I was a really good Catholic. And then I was an atheist for all of high school. And then in college, I became an astrologer. And there's this really annoying impulse with like Filipinos who I think don't want to acknowledge that we have a fair bit of whiteness and like Chinese mestizo-ness to ourselves. We want to pretend that we are like the perfect victim indigenous people. Then like if we go back to our pre-Christian stories and our pre-Christian polytheisms, like we are absolved of anything that Filipinos have done to, and when I say Filipino, I mean like Spanish mestizos that we have done to indigenous people who still exist and are still like, they're kind of like uncontacted tribes in the Philippines. So I don't know. I think, what am I saying? I'm saying that Passion Play is going reverse chronological for a reason. I wanted to start with a folk play that I'm familiar with, that my mother grew up seeing. And then in the final act, it will be the furthest back act, which is when Jesuits are processing Saints of Relics through Manila. So yeah, I think what I wanna show is like the priests, as you go backwards, are wider and more evil. But like the first priest in my play in the 70s, it's like, he's conflicted, but he's like basically fine. And he's gonna run off to the hills and be a gorilla. But there's a lot of conflict there. I don't know. That was my answer, but whatever. I felt a little called out, but I had to say stuff.
Anybody else wanna speak to relationships to hard stories? I saw you, Ariel, yeah.
I was just having a thought because I was invited by she doesn't like to be called my boss, but she's basically my boss. She's the pastor at my church. And she had invited me to preach this summer and I haven't preached yet. And I'm the children's minister. And she was like, you're going to preach on Bathsheba. I was very excited about it. But the only thing I could think about is Bathsheba was raped. That's all I could think about. And I went to her in the office and I said, I'm the children's minister. Do you really want me to give this message? And she goes, no, that's probably not a very children-friendly message. And so I appreciate your question because now I think about the stories that I did include in my project, and I could have chosen to focus a little bit more on the violence that was in some of them, but I didn't. And now I feel challenged to write that sermon anyway and give it because I think it's a message that needs to be told. And now I still feel very glad that I'm now preaching about Esther for my first sermon at my new church. It's probably a good choice, but now I feel very challenged to talk about Bathsheba because that's a story that gets told. It's the King David story, but it's not. So thank you for your question, Max.
We maybe could do one more question. I'm mindful of time. Yeah, Jacques. Yes. Yes. Please.
Good work, everyone. Very inspiring. Thank you. This question, I think, could be for anyone, but I'm specifically asking Fred Isabel and Stephanie, and you don't all have, please don't all answer, just whoever's moved. But you know, in Fred, in your talk, in Fred's talk, you're talking about this like grasping for something that's never gonna be held onto. I think Isabel and Stephanie, you both spoke on the similarities of your projects and the sort of challenges that you put yourself through and that sort of wildness that comes maybe unnamed from within and the theological journey and practice of sort of just feeling that authentically as an art form. And maybe I'm asking for like, I'm gonna have to take this class too. What are your tips? But also like, what sort of tips do you have, like from your experience in this class and the practice of making this project, what sorts of material words or encouragement do you have for other artists who maybe think similarly in terms of, I wanna grasp something, but I have no idea what it looks like, but the grasping feels so right. And that sort of just like wanting to feel more and trust more of the deep wildness in my gut and maybe a little afraid to do so. So take it away.
I think you answered your own question.
Matthew would tell you that it doesn't matter if you're good. It just matters that you do it.
Trust the process. And maybe with that word, we'll conclude. Please join me in thanking our artists. Thank you to our attendees on Zoom. Yeah. And please enjoy some refreshments as you depart. Thank you.
Dr. A.F.